As Richard said, I work at Jamie Oliver, and I went to Jamie Oliver. It's the first non-broadcasting role that I've had. Traditionally, worked at the BBC, Channel 4, Discovery, and now Jamie. I wanted to start by showing you this video. It's quite enlightening.
Fingertip shopping will be one of the many homemaker's conveniences. This video console will be channeled into the store of her choice. There, a camera will scan a display of wares, which she will select by push button. Another part of this console is a household monitor screen, which maintains a watch on critical areas in the house, swimming pool, or yard. What the wife selects on her console will be paid for by the husband at his counterpart console. All bills and transactions will be carried out electronically. A central bank computer will debit the family's account the amount of purchases and credit the department store, for example, informing the family's home computer at the same time. Father, at the touch of a button, receives an instantaneous printed copy of his budget, the amount of taxes he owes, the payments left on the car, and so forth. All documents and household records are available on the video screen for immediate reference. Also at his disposal is an electronic correspondence machine, or home post office, which allows for instant written communication between individuals anywhere in the world. To maintain these and hundreds of complex electronic circuits, a monitor checks all circuits every few seconds, inserts a backup circuit if and when trouble develops, and alerts the communal service agency for replacement.
Totally all come true. 1966, not a fake video, real. So I wanted to talk about how the pace of change and the change in our customers' needs are changing with such velocity of speed. And historically, businesses have given us services, products and services that they've just created and we've consumed without question. And that was the old model. The new model is very different indeed. The change in customer behavior is being driven by all of these things behind me. So purchase power, whether we have it, whether we don't. Traditionally, we would save up for things. Now we don't. We buy it on the never-never. Our attitude to purchase, what our motivations are, they've all shifted and changed. The technology has changed beyond compare, from that video in 1966 right through to Amazon really owning our shopping experience now. I thought this was quite a sobering statistic, that it took Marks and Spencer's over 100 years to get to 24 million customers. Facebook, it took 8 years to get to 1 billion, and now they have 1 billion every single day. And meanwhile, things that we now take for granted and our changes in our customer behavior, you know, 50 years ago, we would say that it was magic. Magic was happening. Like the driverless car, complete magic. 50 years ago, we would describe that as being magic. So, nothing is standing still now. Everything is moving really, really quickly. Democratization of content, people creating games and apps and technologies in their bedrooms, music, video. We just saw all of the YouTubers completely changing our markets and our business models. Somebody on the board at Jamie Oliver said to me recently, and I kid you not, so why is digital so important? I don't get it. And I was like, well, it's these lot, it's the millennials, that's why. And the change in customer behavior. You can't ignore digital now. So With most of us having 3.5 connected devices, this is a Cisco stat, we are more and more being driven by products and services that are delivered to us digitally. So, talking about how we have created small innovations historically in my roles, when I was at the BBC, we created a department. This was in 1998, at the very start of the internet. It was all dial-up. And what we did was we created a little department called Fiction Lab. And I had a complete career change a year before that. I was writing for Tomorrow's World. I was a happily resting actor and just doing this writing gig before I went off on an Alan Ayckbourn tour, which was, you know, yeah. So I the potential for communicating in a different way and telling stories in a different way just completely engulfed my imagination. And I went off and did the Alan Ayckbourn tour and came back and started working for Tomorrow's World, and we launched that website. Roll forward a year, and I had to, there was a chap at the BBC who was very, very senior called Alan Yentob, and I remember being called into his office and asked to show him how to use a mouse. And so that was 1998. And so, Fiction Lab, we created this place for people to go in the department, in the BBC, where they could come and they could bring an idea that wasn't a TV or a radio idea. They could come and bring something else that would be made for the dial-up internet. And we created this department literally with a cupboard and a printer, and people came. And they came on what was called an attachment. So they came and spent 6 months with us. They brought their idea, they made it, and then they went back into the department and became digital evangelists throughout the BBC, which is amazing. And then I went to Channel 4, and then I went to Discovery. And at Discovery, we wanted to look at doing video on demand. And we were looking at the technology, which is why I was asking if Dave was here, because we worked on this briefly together. We were looking at the technology to distribute video globally to work to these video on demand deals, and it was really expensive technology. So what we did was I went down to the Playout Center, pulled off some videos, copied videos, and literally boxed up videos and sent them to Sky for our video on demand platform, and then boxed them up and sent them to all of our video on demand partners. So again, that was innovation, but without a big upfront capital investment. So that's kind of been the theme of my career, is looking at innovation and looking at new markets, new products, new services. So how are we doing that at Jamie Oliver? This is how we're doing
it. Oh my God! Woo! Trying to reconnect. I love it.
YouTube.
When we try and reconnect.
YouTube's on.
Hello, you lovely people. It's Mr. Oliver. It's Wednesday. Is it Wednesday? It's Thursday. And I'm here to talk about something very exciting that I've been working on for about 6 months. 5-day veggie challenge, guys. I hope you're all really well. If I may explain what the 5-day veggie challenge is, we've built a world where for 5 days, and it's a closed group, so only the people that sign up can come and join. We are going to cook vegetarian food Monday to Friday, breakfast, lunch and dinner. And I'm not a vegetarian, I'm not a vegan.
Thanks. So, Jamie's had a book underneath his desk for about 8 years, and it's a vegetarian cookery book. And it's a veggie book, all veggie recipes, but it's aimed at meat eaters, to put more veg back into their diet and to save the environment by not eating as much meat, save money by not eating as much meat, and having a healthier diet. And he's been taking this book for 8 years to Penguin and to his UK broadcaster, Channel 4, for 8 years. And for 8 years, they've said, nah, no, nobody's interested in veg. Nobody's interested in it. It won't sell. We won't get any viewers to watch it. No. So we launched a digital product to see if we could find an audience for this veg book and this veg TV series. And it was called 5-Day Veg Challenge, and we built it completely in-house. We did get vendors to come in and quote for us because we're quite time poor and resource restricted there. However, it was a significant investment for us to take it externally. So we paused some of our technical debt and backlog, actually introducing JIRA and agile project methodologies into Jamie Oliver was an interesting exercise. Revolutionary, but it kind of tells you how non-techie an environment it is. So we created this product, 5-Day Veggie Challenge. We kept it to 5 days so that we didn't have to invest in the future of it, like you would an app, you'd have to upgrade it. So it was a web-based app, and it we integrated with Braintree. It was paid for, it was £2, and it was just an experiment in whether or not we could find an audience for this book and TV series idea that he had. So we created 10 or maybe it was 12 exclusive recipes, and he went on Facebook, he did this video, did a Facebook Live, that was it, that was all the marketing we did for it. And sure enough, we did actually find an audience for it. So In those 5 days, we had 120,000 subscribers. The profit margin was £1.33 out of every £2. Interestingly, 84% female. Our usual demographic is slightly lower female than that. It's usually around 60%. A stat that's not on here, actually, which was very illuminating, was that it was 99% iPhone, which was extraordinary. It was international, but predominantly the audience was UK, although we did have quite a strong following from Brazil, where I subsequently learned that it's the biggest market for vegans, so we're going to be launching a vegan product in Brazil. So it was phenomenally successful. 5 days, 120,000 people. So we went back to Penguin, and we went back to Channel 4, and guess what? Book's coming out in May next year, TV series June. So we were able to go to Channel 4 and Penguin and say, we've done some new product development, we've found an audience, will you commission it? And they've said, yeah. So what we've learned from that, we've learned loads, a ton of data around when people engaged, when they didn't engage, how they used Facebook, how we used Facebook. We did a little spot of paid marketing just to test it. Did not convert at all. In fact, the customer acquisition number was like £134. So that didn't work. So it was all organic. But what we learned from a new product development perspective was that digital's really great at delivering data back to you that you can interrogate and interpret and then test further hypotheses. We've taken that learning. We did this in May, and we've taken it. What we found was that we have historically used personas to deliver products and services. You know, the traditional marketing-led personas to deliver products and services to our audience. But what we found with doing the 5-Day Veggie Challenge was that the audience were unpredictable. They didn't fall into those neat little demographic boxes. And when I was Googling unpredictable people, I found this quote, which I just couldn't resist putting in there. Not amused you, though. So these were the traditional personas that we use. But what we've moved on to is what are the jobs to be done that our audience come to Jamie Oliver to do. So we know that they come to look at recipes. We know that they shop those recipes. But what else do they want? We sold a million copies of the five ingredients book last year in the UK alone. We don't know a single thing about those customers because they're all sold by retailers. We don't know anything about the people that watch his TV programs all around the world. So we've moved into this jobs to be done model, and What that is understanding what people are coming to us to do and what their intent is. And we landed on this because we were looking at some research and working with a third party called Albion. And they did this work with McDonald's, and McDonald's wanted to increase their revenue around the milkshakes. They weren't selling very well, and they wanted to understand why they weren't selling very well. They declined in sales. So they noticed through their data that in the morning that the sales were strongest of these milkshakes. And they were thinking, well, why in the morning? Why would people have milkshakes in the morning? And they couldn't think of a reason. So they investigated, and essentially what was happening was the job to be done for people buying these milkshakes in the morning was breakfast. So they were driving to work, they were in the car, they needed to eat breakfast, they didn't want to get crumbs down their work suit, they wanted something that would be milk-based, that sort of breakfasty, and something that was easy that they could put in their cup holder and have on the go as they went into work without getting crumbs all over them. And that was the job that milkshakes were doing for McDonald's for thousands of people in America. So they did something really simple. They, you know, the revolving menus that you get in McDonald's, they just put milkshakes on the at breakfast time on that revolving menu, and the sales just went through the roof. So they knew that the job to be done was breakfast for milkshakes. So we've adopted this model, and we are actually at the moment testing some hypotheses around the jobs to be done and the intent for going to the Jamie Oliver website and then defining products and services, digital products and services, around those jobs to be done. So we've turned the whole, the way that people work in silos at the organization, we've completely turned that upside down. So what we've got are people collaborating together at pace with lots of different disciplines and putting all of our ideas around what we think the jobs to be done are then testing those hypotheses against the data that we've got. We also had quite a lot of anonymized data. We had data from the restaurant group. We had data from the foundation. We had data from the restaurant gold card. And we had data from the Jamie Oliver website for people who'd subscribed. And so what we did was we smashed all of that anonymized data together and we looked at where the crossover were. And we found that people that were Gold Club card members were also Jamie Oliver subscribers on the website, and they were also using the Alexa skill. So what is it that we can create for them that that will satisfy their intent? And what we have done is we've started to look at loyalty, and we've implemented an identity and access management platform to embark on that journey. So that's how we're doing it. We are continually revising our new product development methodologies. The jobs to be done phrase has gained currency internally in our department. We've gone from an organization where it was thought that digital was just that geeky lot in the corner over there into an organization that has digital advocates in each department. Digital has not become a competitor to those other bits of the business, they've become an enabler. So the language has changed. And although we are earning standalone revenues, significant ones as well, we are enabling the rest of the business. And so there has been quite a substantial digital transformation organizationally in addition to adopting these new methodologies. So that's our process now. So the overarching strategy is to sell more physical products, so pots and pans and spatulas and whisks and ovens, barbecue, all of that stuff that he does. And we launched a Jamie Oliver shop to meet that strategic objection, objective. And then we've mapped all of our customer touch points, of which there were so many, so we've switched a lot of them off because it felt like we were shouting at everybody. And we've done our research, we're looking at the data, we are testing the jobs to be done hypotheses, and then we're launching minimum viable products like the 5-day veggie challenge and the shop as well, and other small services like recommendations, like add to basket, like recipes, so that we can test and learn from them. So I just wanted to say and end again on the changing customer behavior. There was an article in The Observer last weekend, and they were talking about how technology will change customer behavior by 2030, and apparently we'll be outsourcing pregnancy to technology by 2030, and sex as well. We'll be outsourcing sex to technology, and in fact, there's a robotic brothel opening up in the UK very soon. Who knew? But let's not forget, being first to market can be tough. And that's why I'm a really passionate advocate of doing it lean, doing it small, not having massive upfront capital investments in these projects, and really, really testing your hypotheses and testing that there is a market out there, just like we did with 5-Day Veg Challenge, and have now commissioned the book and TV series. This guy, Steve Sasson, does everybody know this story? Yeah? So, very briefly, for those that don't, he took the first digital camera, he was the inventor of it, he worked at Kodak, and he took it to his bosses, and they went, yeah, that's nice, but don't tell anyone. And so the digital camera didn't get invented by Kodak, and look what happened to Kodak. And that is it, as they say. I've got no idea what time I've got, because I can't see. But if you've got questions, in fact, we have got questions. Having proven your point with digital, why go back to traditional publishing broadcast? Because that's the core revenue. So while the revenues were small in digital, we were able to go back to our core revenue drivers and say there is a market for this. But yes, it's a very fair point, and I think that will transition slowly away from the core revenue to more digital revenues as we go along. The shop, incidentally, that we launched in August is proving that point. So physical product, but selling it digitally, has been food for thought organisationally. There was another question there, if I got time for it. Why did I investigate why it was 99% on iPhones? I was just really curious. And I think because we were toying with the idea of Apple Pay, and we didn't do it because we didn't have time. And so we just did PayPal and credit card payments. So we used the same payment gateway that ITV uses. Hardly anybody used that. They all use PayPal, which again was an interesting stat for us, having spent quite a significant amount of our time from a tech resource perspective implementing credit card payment. But yes, that's why, because we were thinking about Apple Pay and whether or not we should be doing Apple Pay. So I went to look at the stats afterwards to see whether that was a question that we needed to answer. And as it turned out, it was.